Welcome back, GIS friends, to the next in our series of GIS tutorials with GRASS 7.8.3. And today what we're going to be doing is covering viewshed analysis, including cumulative and total viewshed creation. And we're going to have to go through a couple of different tools, and we're actually getting into more of the advanced parts of GRASS GIS at this point. So it might be useful if you haven't been following along last few weeks to sort of review some of the basic stuff with GRASS, because I have to spend more time on some of the advanced stuff today. So we're not going to get a lot of refreshers of the basics. However, there is one thing that I want to start with, which is a cool new feature, I believe, in GRASS 7.8. I don't know if GRASS 7.6 is doing this at the moment. And that has to do with something that I stumbled on in a previous video because it had changed, which is thematic mapping with vectors. And, you know, this happens all the time when you get new versions of software, and, you know, a little bit of the blame is on me because I wasn't following along particularly closely with the development threads over on the GRASS developers mailing list, which I am technically a part of. And so this sort of slipped past me until, you know, I tried to demonstrate and then things had changed. So always is important to keep up with the latest changes. So also forgive if there's any noise. It's a rainy day here and I'm in the garage and I have to keep the door open. Otherwise it's super dark in here and you wouldn't be able to see me. So hopefully you'll be able to hear me over the garbage truck, which just pulled up over there. Okay, so thematic mapping, very quickly, just a little addition here. I've got in the background our shaded relief map that I've added with the color of the topographic map, or the DEM laid over it, just like I showed you way back when. So that's the sort of the backdrop here. And I'm going to quickly add in those vector points from the Neolithic lithic scatters that I showed you how to extract in the a previous video. And if you just do that, by default now it makes the symbol a point. It used to be the little X symbol, but now it's a point symbol. And it's a little hard to see, but if we go into the properties and we go to the symbols, and right now it's the point. I'm just going to change it to the regular circle. It's a size 7, and hit apply. Oh, you can see by default the points are all colored random colors. And if we go to the colors tab over here, let me make this window just a little bit bigger than it normally is. See, by default, there's a checkbox that says assign random colors, right? So if you want them to be all one color, like for example, all red, you have to uncheck that box, then go in and select the fill color as red, and then now they're all red. But you also see there's a few new things here, which is colorize feature according to color definition column, or Z coordinate. And I believe you can just pick a numeric column here. Oh yeah, this is what I discovered. It's not, this has to be RGB values, but in the symbol size, you've got a numeric column for the symbol size. And that's something that we can pick now, like maximum length. Now, when you hit apply, everything's going to look huge. And the reason is that it multiplies whatever's in this column by the number that's in the symbol size column over here. So if we change that to 1, so it only multiplies by 1, you can see they get smaller. You can even change this to a fraction, 0.25, there, right? The other option, we can leave this as 1, is to check this thing that says use the square root of the symbol size column, and that often gets it right into the range that you're looking for in terms of a nice spread of different sizes for your symbols over here. They also allow you to rotate the symbol according to a numeric column as well. Now, with a circle symbol, it's not going to do anything. But if we choose one of these, let's just say this plus sign. Actually, let's choose a narrow arrow like that, just so you can see it would normally look like this. In fact, we're going to make all our symbols just a little bit bigger so you can actually see this. And then we're going to pick, let's say, this one. And you can see they all rotate, according to the number in there. Now, this would make most sense if this was like aspect, simply because, there's a lot of positions around the clock and they'll start repeating them. So it won't make a lot of sense if the number doesn't line up within that 0 to 360 degree, you know, expectation, but we can do that. Well, here we have aspect, right? So we can actually see the aspect of all the sites displayed in this case as an arrow. And this is pretty neat, you know, if aspect is a meaningful thing that you're mapping, whether it's an archaeological site or, for example, the strike of a geologic formation or something like that, you can easily, very quickly display that as long as you have a column in your vector file that that is meaningful. You know, slope would probably do something. Let's just see what it would look like. Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit off north because slope is 0 to 90 degrees max. So, you know, it does, it could, as long as you explain that. But probably the most interesting thing would be to use something like aspect over here. So I'm going to zero that out. And I am going to go back to my circle symbol. And I'm going to go back to just this one, like so. Like so. Just so we can see here, we have a little bit of thematic information, which is great. It's not particularly necessary for the rest of this lesson, but I thought it was cool, so I thought I'd show you very quickly how to do that. And, oh, just one other thing is if you want to add a little explanation, you go up to here where it says add map elements, and you go to where it says add vector legend, and then you get this D legend vect, and what you want to do is, let's see, layout, title. You can set all this stuff up if you want. I'm just making sure there's nothing super important. And just hit apply. And at this moment, it shows up over here, right? So, okay. And I'm going to right-click on that and remove it because it's going to get in the way of our visibility analysis that we want to do a little later here. Okay, so we talked on Tuesday about view sheds, line of sights, visibility analysis, the concept of visual scapes and cumulative view sheds and total view sheds. Just as a refresher, line of sight is what you can see in any given direction. Any part of the landscape that falls within your vision is in the line of sight. Anything that's like behind on the other side of the mountain or blocked by something is not in your line of sight. In fact, anything that's off to the periphery is not in your line of sight. As you start to rotate around all points of the compass, you can draw many lines of sights, and anything that is visible along any of those lines of sight becomes your view shed. Basically, what's visible in a 360-degree panorama from this particular viewing point. And then I talked about the idea that that's a view shed from a specific location. If you start to add together multiple view sheds from multiple locations, you come up with the concept of the cumulative view shed, which is the total percentage of the landscape that can be seen from your set of viewing points. And this can be just a single amalgamation, everything that is visible versus everything that's not. Oftentimes, what's more interesting is to add up how many sites can see every individual pixel of the landscape from your different viewing points, so that you'll have a theoretic number from zero to the total number of viewing sites coded around the landscape, and it tells you which parts of the landscape are most visible from your viewing location and which parts are not visible at all or less visible from those sets of viewing points. And then finally, I talked about total view shed, which is to take that concept and instead of selecting viewing locations for their importance, archaeological sites or buildings or what have you, you instead randomly sample, just set up a random set of viewing points spread across the landscape, and you calculate the total view shed in the same way, except instead of something that's potentially culturally meaningful, you're simply quantifying the total visibility of the different parts of the landscapes. Is the mountain visible from your sites because people wanted to see it and they selected very carefully places that could see the mountain? Or is it just the tall mountain that's visible from any place in the landscape? So chances are, wherever you put your site, you're going to have a view of that mountain. And this allows you to analyze that. And finally, what we'll do is we'll show you how to normalize those two things so that you can compare them on a scale from 0 to 1. And then I'll show you how to use the map calc to extract that information to plug into the predictive model that is Project 3. that we talked about in a previous video when we talked about how to use the map calc. So what we'll start with is simply calculating one single viewshed. And the tool to do that is in the raster menu, and it's down in our familiar terrain analysis tab, and it's the one that says visibility r.viewshed. And this is a fairly simple tool, but it allows you to very highly customize your output. So we'll go through all of the customization procedures. So the first thing is to put in the name of the elevation file, and that is our HASA 30 meter SRTM. And the name for our test output raster map, in this case, I'm just going to call it test, but if you're doing this with a known place, you should give it a name that evokes the name of the site. So if I picked site 256, I should call this site 256 viewshed or something like that. In fact, let's just do that. I'm just going to pick this large site over here with the query tool. And this is, let's see, under attributes, it is site number 564. So I'm going to do that. Site 564 viewshed. Okay. And the coordinates, luckily for us, when we query, it shows up right here in the east-north, and we can right-click on that and just copy the coordinates, and then I can paste them in over here. So we're set up, standing right there on top of our site 564. We're going to make our viewshed. So our settings, remember we talked about in class how you can change the viewing elevation above the surface of the ground and the viewed elevation. And that's important for if we're modeling a human at 1.5 or 1.75 meters above the surface, standing upright, depending on how tall or short your people are. You go taller if it's somebody on horseback, or if it's somebody in a tower, you can go like 10 meters tall if you wanted to. And that would change the visibility from that particular point. And then the offset for the target elevation. So by default, you're looking at the actual surface of the Earth. But perhaps you're interested in if you could see a person standing on that particular point in the landscape. So you could offset this 1.75 meters. Or it could be a person on horseback. So it could be like 3 meters. Or it could be trees or buildings. So you could go 5, 10 meters or something like that to see what could be seen. I tend to leave it at zero because the surface of the ground is good enough of a proxy if we don't have that particularly, anything like that particularly in mind. And then down here, the maximum visibility radius, by default, it's set to infinity, so you should be able to see forever. You could set a value here. Usually 5 or 10 kilometers is a pretty reasonable value, so you could just put in 10,000 here for 10 kilometers. We also have the ability to model the refraction of the atmosphere. So you can check this box, and if you know what this coefficient is, you could change it to make it dustier or clearer. And when you check this box, you also have to go to the optional tab and check the consider the curvature of the Earth, which means there's going to be horizon line. Sorry, flat earthers. The Earth is round. So basically, this takes into account the curvature of the ellipsoid, which is probably a good idea to do, even though we've put that 10 kilometer radius. And then finally, in the output format, we'll get to that in just a little bit, because this is going to become important when we want to style this for our predictive model, but we're going to leave that alone for now. You could up the memory if you want this to run faster. I often give it like 4 gigabytes to run, and we just hit go, and it goes pretty quick. Ignore this error that pops up on my screen. This is due to the way that I've installed GRASS 783 on my Linux computer. Shouldn't show up on yours, and if it does, it actually doesn't do anything. So what do we have? We have over here in the window, let me just move myself over here. Anything in purple is visible, and anything that's the map below is invisible. All right, so actually there's not that much actually visible from our large site, which is kind of interesting. Now, it may be hard for you to kind of see this, so you may want to go back into our viewshed over here, and in the output format, check this one where it says output format is invisible coded as 0, visible coded as 1. And this is what we'll want to do if we wanted to include this in some sort of predictive model. If we wanted to drape it over in 3D, this kind of looks a little bit better. So what I'll do is I'll go to the optional tab, and I'll allow it to overwrite, and I'll just run it again. And there we go, right? So that anything in yellow is seen, and anything in purple is not able to be seen. Now, that might be interesting in and of itself. Maybe we want to do the comparison of this viewshed to, I don't know, this site over here. So let's select that and query this guy over here. And in our query tab, we can figure out that this next one is site 1054. So if we bring up our viewshed, we go to the required tab. We can, did I do that right? Yeah. I have it up multiple times. This is me testing it out before. Okay, so back to the required tabs, and you see where I said site 564. We can now enter site, what did I say, 1054? Yeah, 1054. 1054 viewshed, and we can go back up here, copy in the new coordinates, and paste those there, and then we can hit run on that guy. And now we can compare. Oh, look at that. I copied in the same coordinates from before. Isn't that fun? Okay, let's query there. Copy those guys. And okay, so that should run. And there we go. So now we have the two different view sheds, you see? So what we can see here is that this little ridge right here is the only real thing that seems to be visible from both those sides. So they have a very different view shed except for this little part of the landscape right here. And what we could do is, if we really wanted to see our collection of sites, we could go one by one by one by one, calculate all the different view sheds, and then sum them up together to get the cumulative view shed. But luckily, you don't have to do that, because I created a little add-on for GRASS that does that for you programmatically. So it just runs through all the points that you give it and then sums it up for you. Now, we haven't talked about add-ons, but add-ons are like little plugins, little extensions for GRASS that can add some functionality for simple things or just little extra things. There's some really, really cool add-ons. And so if you want to look at them, you can go to the GRASS website, grass.osgo.org, and go to the add-ons tab, and you can read through the, there's hundreds of different add-ons for imagery, for rasters, for vector analysis, and they have a little blurb about all of them, and then you can install them through the method that I'm going to show you here, which is under the settings tab, add-ons extensions, and then it says install extension from add-ons. And you get this little thing that says G extension, or fetch and install extensions from GRASS add-ons. And then you have all of these are the different menu items up here. So this is the add-on that's going to be added in. And then you can take some time and explore what's in here. But our one that we want to add is in the raster menu item. And we're going to scroll way down to the bottom and find r.viewshed.cva. That stands for cumulative viewshed analysis. And you just hit install. And I'm not going to do it because I've already got it installed on here. Don't need to overwrite it, but it will download it, compile it, and put it into the GRASS install tree so that you can use it. And there's a couple ways, once it's installed, for you to actually access it. One is through the modules add-ons, and then there it is there. Another way is to type it into the console, or if you have a window in the back, you can type in r.viewshed.cva with a little ampersand so it doesn't lock your window down. And, oh, but CVS. CVS is the drugstore. CVA is the thing that we want, right? So then it pops up the module and you can work in it. And I wanted to just show you that from the modules, you can just double click on it too, like that. So that's probably the easiest way to find it, under the add-ons tab here, and the modules tab. And you could probably launch it here too. Oh, I never actually run things from here, so there it is. Pops up just like that, but a lot of people use that to do it. And in fact, you can put in the name of anything in here, like just regular viewshed. Should be able to just hit enter and it pops up. So, you know, you don't always have to go into the menu items. There's multiple ways to launch the tools in GRASS. In fact, if you really know everything, you could do it all from the command line without the graphical interface at all. So if you want to feel like a computer whiz, you know, like Mr. Robot, you can do it that way as well. Okay, so here we are, our Viewshed CVA. It looks very similar to our Viewshed because I simply built it on top of it, and it has just one additional functionality, which is to roll through all the sets of points in your input vector map. So we're going to do the same inputs. We're going to put HASA 30 meter SRTM. We're going to put our input vector map is going to be our Neolithic lithic scatters or whatever sites you pulled out. And then our output is going to be Neolithscatcumulativeviewshed. I'm trying to make the name not super long, right? So I'm abbreviating a little bit. And so we're going to make the cumulative view shed. Under the optional tab, you could potentially keep all the interim view sheds. So if you just wanted to generate a view shed for a whole bunch of sites at one go, that's a useful thing. You would check that box. We don't necessarily need to keep them all, so we're not going to do that. We can check the consider the curvature of the Earth and the effect of atmospheric refraction. Why not? We're going to leave everything else the same. Everything else is pretty much at default. Oh, the target areas off the ground will change back to zero. And we can change that to our 10,000 and our amount of memory. Why not make it go a little faster by giving it most of the RAM? And if we wanted to keep the maps like that, if we wanted to do this, keep all the interim maps, we could give it give the maps each a prefix based on a column from the database, like site name. But we're not doing that, so we don't have to worry about that. And we're going to hit run, and this is going to take a little while. So what I am going to do is pause the video. And when the routine is done, I will show you what it actually looks like. So hang on and we'll... All right, I think we are back. So the routine has finished. It actually didn't take that long. It took about 10 minutes or so, maybe even less than that. I was checking my email, etc., so I wasn't really paying that much attention. But it finished, and this is what it looks like over here, which is pretty cool. So if we, if we add a raster legend here and we just add that to our map and, maybe I style it so that you can actually read the numbers. Font settings. There it is. Let's change the font to white. Click okay. There we go. So you can see the numbers go from 0 to 16, and if we go over to our guy over here, and where are we? There we are. And we look at the metadata, and we see that there are 34 total points. So that's interesting. It's a little less than half. The total number of points is the actual maximum number of sites that can see the same place, and it all seems to be lined up along this ridge over here. And what we might want to do now is, once we've done this, is to ask ourselves, well, is it because people in the Neolithic really wanted to look at that ridge? Is that a culturally significant ridge? Is that where the sun rises or something like that, and they all wanted to be looking over that ridge at a particular time of year? Or is it just that, based on the topography of the region, that's just a highly visible part of the landscape? That ridge is just up and easy to see from most places. So to answer that question, what we have to do is do that total viewshed analysis so that we can compare it. Just real briefly, before we get into that, what I'd like to do is to just go in to our shaded relief map over here. And instead of the SRTM, I'm going to put that cumulative viewshed up over it so we can actually see. So that should hopefully make it a little easier for you to view. Let's make it a little brighter. There we go. So we can see this is the ridge that we're talking about. So that should hopefully make it a little bit easier for you all to figure out what I'm talking about. Is it this ridge right here that's just particularly visible, or are all of these sites oriented so that they have a view of that part of the landscape? Because I don't know, let's say in the summer solstice or something like that, the sun rises in the east above that, and they all want to look over that ridge. It's just a hypothesis off the top of my head. It has no basis in anything. I'm just throwing it out there as a little bit of a straw man, okay? So, how do we go about comparing this analysis to the total viewshed? Well, the first thing that we want to do is to normalize this map. So, right now we have this 0 to 16. Theoretically, it should be 0 to 34 because we have 34 total viewing points. So if a site was universally viewable from all 34 points, it should be coded 34 in this. So all we have to do is to go into our map calculator and do a little math. So we're going to insert our cumulative viewshed, and we're simply going to divide it by 34, the theoretical maximum number, and the name is going to be, I'm just going to copy, it's copy and paste, and I'm going to do normalized, right? So the value of 0 is still invisible. A value of 1 is perfectly visible from every site, and anything between that is going to be a fraction. And just to make sure we get a fraction, we're going to put 34.0, so that's floating point math. And that should do it, so we will hit run. And we get a map that looks should look exactly the same in terms of color wise, but if we go in here and oops. Okay. And we go to the input and we changed it to our normalize. But now we have a floating point map. And here that the maximum is now 0.47 because remember 16 is not 34, so it's only half, a little less than half the sites are able to see those particular locations. And you know, if we wanted to, we can go back over to our layers tab and we could put that normalized one. Where is our D GUI? There it is. Okay. We could put that over here instead of the other one that we made. So the normalized one is what we're actually viewing on our background, even though it looks exactly the same. Okay, so in terms of the total viewshed, what should we do? Well, firstly, what we need to do is figure out how many cells we have and what percentage of those cells we want to make into viewing points. Now, because our Neolithic sites are sort of clustered here into the middle of the map, my suggestion is to simply zoom in to a reasonable bounding box like so, and then set the save or set computational region extent from display. Now, if I scroll out just a little, you see the red box that outlines our computational region is just this part of the map, and that means anything we do is going to be constrained simply to that part of the map. And so back over here, I can actually, what I can do is right here where we have the zoom menu. Where is it? Right there. I can then zoom to the default region, which will set it just back to what we were looking at before. You'll notice the box for our region is the same. Now, up here under raster, I can go down where it says generate random cells, and I'll use the one that says cells and vector points, because that's what we need as input to our RViewShed CVA, r.random. And at this point, we could create some number of cells. But what we might want to do very quickly is to figure out like how many actual raster cells are here. And for that, What we could do is to go up to raster, reports and statistics, and we can go to r.stats, or actually probably easier to interpret as r.univariate raster statistics. And what we'll do is we'll pull in our SRTM map, and oops, for some reason it zoomed in when I clicked behind there. Where were we? There we are. Okay. So we're going to do raster statistics on our SRTM in the region that's here. And I think we just hit run. And it should tell us the total number of cells. And again, this is respecting the region boundary. So this is not in the whole map. This is just within our red box. And here it looks like this particular map has 1.4 million cells. So what we could do is copy that number and open up a little calculator, paste it in there, and multiply it by like 0.001%. And I could do 1,400 if I really want to do it by percentage, right? In fact, what I could do is add another zero to there and do 140 points just for theoretical, robustness. I can say without a doubt that we're dealing here with 0.01% sample size. You could do it that way. You could do it the same number of viewing points, so 34 and 34, so 34 archaeological sites, 34 random points. In this case, it doesn't really matter because we're going to normalize it. So just pick a good number. You could choose 1,000 if you wanted to. Doesn't really matter, right? I'm just doing this for, if you were going to publish these results, you can at least just say, I chose 0.01% as, just as a good rule of thumb. So let's do that. Let's go back to our random. And name of input map is going to be that guy there. Number of points to allocate is going to be 140. And you could do this as a percentage too. So if you really just wanted to, you could put in like 1% and it would figure out however many points that is. But since we know exactly how much we want to do, 140, we're going to do that. And then basically, that's all we really have to do. We don't need to do anything else. We just hit run. Did I hit run? Okay, there we go. What did I forget to do? Oh, I forgot to put the name of the output map, of course. So we're going to put 140 rand V points, viewpoints. We're just going to hit run. Oh, and again, look at me breaking my rules and starting with a number. Rand viewpoints, 140 at the end, so it doesn't give me that error. There we go. Okay, so now we can close our random, we can close our univer. And in fact, you see the little sprinkling of random points. I'm just gonna open up the display and we're gonna change this to a larger symbol. There we go. So now you can see that they are, in fact, randomly distributed and only within our red box over here. That's 140 new viewing points. And at this point, we are ready to do our Viewshed CVA again. So I'm just bringing up the same module I had it up from before. So we're going to leave the same input elevation map. We are going to change the name of the input vector point to our RAND viewpoints 140. And the output is going to be HASA total viewshed. This is the actual total viewshed, regardless of any human interaction. This is what is generally visible in this area. And everything else that we had in here, we're going to leave exactly the same. And we're going to hit run. And then I'm going to pause again the video so that it can do its thing. And I will come back when. All right, I think we're back on again. Again, that didn't take particularly long on my computer. And the routine has completed, and you can see the total viewshed in the background over there. So if we go back over here, what we can do is move our random points up. Here we go. So those are the viewpoints that we used. We can minimize that. And our total viewshed analysis, and the image that you're seeing back there is in fact our total cumulative or total viewshed from those random points. So let's go ahead and pick that Hasa total viewshed, click OK, and you can see I have a totally different raster legend there for that. And I'm gonna change my font back to white so you can see it. And you can see if I put it up here that 13 is the maximum for our randomly scattered points. So kind of interesting there, seeing that we put in 140 points and the maximum the cell that has the maximum number of viewing angles from those sets has only 13 of them able to see it. So even less than the one we did for our cumulative viewshed, which is kind of interesting. But is it actually a meaningful difference? So what we'll want to do is to get up our raster map calculator again and load in that total viewshed that we just made, Hasa total viewshed, and we're going to divide that by 140.0 so that it comes out in decimals. And over here, I'm just going to copy that name, paste it up into the name over here, and put an underscore normalized. So it's going to be from 0 to 1 again. And then I'm going to hit run. Okay, and so that is done. And back over here, we have our normalized map. And we can move that down here. And now, if I go into this guy and go up to the input, and changed it to normalize, we see that we actually have it. It's almost identical, actually, from 0 to 0.47. So that's suspicious to me that I didn't actually put the right map in there. But I did. You can see it's actually different. So, in fact, what I think I did is picked the wrong one here. So let's just make sure that I'm doing this thing correctly. There we go. That's what I did. I picked the wrong map for the legend. So 0.93 is the maximum. So like only 1% of the sites can view versus almost 50% of the sites viewing the maximum one over there, which is kind of an interesting difference. And so now if we sort of flash back and forth between those, we can start to see which parts are visible in both of them, which is kind of an interesting thing. And it looks like our ridge that we were looking at right here is actually pretty visible. So if we query over here on it, in fact, what we'll do is highlight both of these normalized guys. And now when we go to our query tool and we can zoom in over here, we can just click around on this ridge and there's our little query boxes. And behind me, there it is. Okay, so if I click around here, we can actually see both maps. So here's our Neolithic lithic scatter normalized and our total viewshed normalized. And we can see the value in both of them. And we can see that, you know, on the relative scale, they're both reasonably visible in terms of, you know, the site location viewing and the random sites viewing as well. So we can conclude from that this ridge over here is actually just pretty kind of visible. We can click around in other pretty highly visible places and we can kind of do the same thing. It looks like in this particular case, in terms of the landscape, they just have whatever view shed they have. The alternative question we can ask is, can those sites all see each other from each other's location more so than they could be seen from this random set of viewpoints? If we want to do that, all we have to do is to go into our Neolithic lithic scatters table for the attribute data, just like we did before when we did our querying, and upload those values into it. So we're going to do show attribute data to get our table over here, and we can make the table a little bit bigger so you can see it. Put me over here, and if we go down to where it says manage tables, and you can see this is the set of columns, we can add some new columns. And so we'll put cum vshid, and we're going to make that a double. I'm going to add it. And then we can put tote vshid and add that. So now we're going to add our cumulative viewshed values, you know, basically the number of sites that can see every point, so the number of sites that can see each site. And then we're going to put in our total viewshed values as well. We're going to use the normalized versions because we want to compare both of them. So to do that, we're going to go back over here. We're going to go to our vector. Then we're going to go to our update attributes. And we're going to do our update point attributes from sample raster map to point locations v what rast. And Neolithic lithic scatters is the vector point. The name of the first map that we're going to query is the lithic scatter cumulative viewshed normalized. And we're going to might as well interpolate from the nearest four cells just in case. And we're going to find our new cum viewshed column. We're going to hit run. 34 records updated. And then we're going to go back to our required tab. And for our raster next raster map, we're going to pick our total viewshed normalized. Back to optional, name of the attribute column, and we're going to change that to our tote viewshed. And hit run. 34 records updated. So we can close VWhat rast. And go back over here, hit refresh, and scroll over. And now we can actually see that we have some values over here. So this is kind of interesting. We can definitely see some higher numbers over here. So we could compare these with our VUnivare. So we can go down to vector, reports and statistics, and then find our VUnivare. And lithic scatters is their vector map. And name of the attribute column, we'll start with cumulative viewshed. We'll hit run. And we'll come back to these numbers in just a second because they're going to stay in the memory there. And the next one that we're going to pick, oops, on the optional tab, is the tote viewshed. And hit run. And then we'll make this guy bigger so that we can see them all together. So what we can see here is the average value from our cumulative viewshed, which is 0.62. And the average value from our total viewshed is only 0.061. And so normalized, that suggests perhaps that the locations of these lithic scatters, they can see there's more intervisibility between those locations and just random points on the landscape. Now, does that prove without a doubt that they located their sites in these places so that they could see each other? Not necessarily, but it does give us an interesting hypothesis to chase down with some other sets of data. Now we can start to think about other ways to verify if these sites were related to each other from the same time period or from the same culture, et cetera, et cetera. We can look at exchange of materials, and we can just start to see if that visibility is actually an important thing. And obviously what we'd want to do is to test this a little bit more rigorously, perhaps with some more random viewing points. But that would be something that we could chase down in a sort of subsequent analysis. Okay, whew, we are almost done. So what we might want to do at this particular point is to talk about just the general visibility of the sites. And so we have our viewshed analysis, total viewshed analysis in the back with those random points. And if we want to add this into our predictive model, we might want to take into account the total visibility because we don't know the location of all the neolithic sites. So that cumulative viewshed map is always going to be a sampling, right? And it's not going to be particularly useful, potentially useful in a predictive model. It could be that it would help us, but since we know, generally speaking, that they have located there, the sites are generally located in not very high visibility areas, we can take our total viewshed map and we can come up with some thresholds, some cutoffs, so that we can incorporate that into our predictive model. And we saw in VUniverse, which unfortunately just closed, so I'm going to open it up again and run it one more time, in that total viewshed column over here. Where is it? Total viewshed. There we go. And what we saw was the mean, right? The average value is like 0.006, right? And we have our sample standard deviation of also 0.0068, or something like that, right? So basically, what we're saying is from 0 to about 0.012, right, is the spread of the sites. And so the maximum visibility on the landscape is 0.29, 0.029. So we can say that, 64% of our sites are located with visibility of 0.012-ish or less. Maybe we can round up to 0.013 or 0.014 just to make sure we're getting enough in there, right? And as I showed you before, we can just take that in the map calculator and use that value as a cutoff. So we'll just open up our map calculator again. We will load in our total viewshed normalized. And what we'll do is we'll write an if statement. So I'll go back to the beginning over here, and I'm just going to type them in here, but you could use the insert functions like I showed you last time. So I'm going to write if Neolithic scatters is less than or equal to 0.01, I'm going to do 1.4, comma, put it as 1, otherwise 0. So we're basically turning this map back into a binary so that we can put it into our simplified version of a predictive model. And what we'll do is this will be tote vshed binary, right? I'm going to input that into our predictive model. So we'll hit run. And that's going to be it. So these areas with 1 theoretically should show more predilection of having one of our known sites on them. And you can see that, yeah, pretty much, right? Pretty much our known sites are located in these areas. So that seems like kind of a powerful thing. And if this is true, if these sites are truly located in generally less visible places, that's an interesting human behavior that we'd want to incorporate into our predictive model. And so when we built our final predictive model, again, we would go back into our map calculator and we would just enter in, all the maps that we want. And I'm going to put open parentheses. So we're going to go in to our, let's see, I think we did total viewshed binary. And we're going to add it to our aspect interior binary. And we're going to add it to our max flow accumulation binary. And we're going to add that to, where's our slope binary? And we're going to add it to our, where's our streams walking time binary? And that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 maps. So we're going to divide by 5.0. And we're going to call this, we have a whole bunch of those predictive models from before. So we're going to do new predictive model. Okay. And we're just going to see what that looks like. Why not? It'll be kind of interesting. And there we are. We have our new predictive model made over here. And what we can do is, even though we built this sort of on information from our known sites, we did abstract a little bit, so we can actually do a final test here to see if our predictive model works with our, you know, at least our known sites. And maybe it will, and maybe it won't a little bit. At least it'll give us a sort of back of the envelope way to test this. Ideally, we would have reserved some number of these sites to use as a testing data set. So we could use, let's say, 75% of them to build the predictive model. And we would reserve 25% of them randomly to test the predictive model. And of course, that's how we would do this if we were going to do this for publication or something like that. But in this case, since we did definitely abstract, we did a little bit of deductive and a little bit of inductive reasoning in our predictive model. We can at least get a general idea of how well it tests by sampling it. And so what we can do is, you guessed it, upload some information into that through VWhatRAST. So let's open the attribute table once again. Whoops. Show attribute data, and we'll go into our managed tables, and we'll do predictive model, and we're going to give it double, we're going to add it, and there it is, and we'll minimize that. Well, we go back up to update attributes VWhatRAST. And now what we're going to do is sample into our new predictive model, and we're going to pick that predictive model column. We're going to hit run. And now we can just look at our data values back on the browse data and refresh, scroll it over. And we can actually see that it seems to be sort of okay, right? There's, generally speaking, the model is predicting better than half, correct, let's say. Generally speaking, we're getting a lot of sixes and eights, which is pretty strong for this model. And of course, we would fine tune our model. We'd go back and change our thresholds, and we might want to weight some of the input values like we showed last time. So maybe visibility is super important. We want to weight it twice. So we could try that again over here. Let's see. We can doubly weight this viewshed binary times 2. And hey, while we're at it, let's also do our streams by 2. So we can doubly weight that one by 2. And then, of course, we have to change that to 7.0. And I'm going to just overwrite our guy there, our model. I'm going to hit run. And didn't I close VWhatRAST? Yeah, I closed VWhatRAST. So I'm going to open VWhatRAST again. And we're going to query our new predictive model, because remember, we just overwrote it. We'll interpolate. And we will overwrite that guy there. And we can refresh. And we're actually getting, looks like, poorer results when we do that. So you can see how you can iterate this and say, maybe it's not the streams. We can go back here and we can hit run again. And We can go back to our v.what.rest, and we can do that, and then we can refresh, and we can keep tuning this until the values get better. And it looks like values got even worse when I did that. So maybe visibility isn't as important as I thought. In fact, oh, that's because I forgot to change that to 6. So we run it again. v.what.rest again. And then refresh. And yeah, values still got worse. So it could be that we don't want to double count our visibility analysis, but we might want to still double count our walking times. So we can do that. And we can do our v.what.rest. And we can refresh. And it looks like we got better across the board. So that's an interesting thing. So walking to streams seems to be more important for our known set of sites than was the visibility. And you can go in and do this with all the different ones. Could be slope, aspect, etc. And you can take some out and leave some in. And what you're trying to do here is to get to a point where your model has the best values, generally speaking. And of course, you ought to be checking this with v.what.rest or v.univer, just so you can get sort of average value with a standard deviation for statistical reasons. And so you can see here that our average is actually not so bad. It's above 50%. So what we're saying is our model is predicting somewhere in that 60%-ish kind of realm in terms of the known sites here. It's predicting a good number of them to a reasonable value. And so hopefully we can tune this predictive model to the point where we're getting pretty good output for our testing data set. And again, ideally that would be a subset that you held apart. But in this case, it's helping us figure out as well. You're not going to get 100%. It's just the nature of predictive modeling. There's always going to be some variability in there. But it's going to help you figure out what parts of the landscape are going to be the places that you want to go. And so here, generally speaking, since this 60%-ish is the sort of general cutoff, if you needed to turn this predictive model into a where are we going to survey, tomorrow, what you could do, you would run it with your latest set of sites. You'd then take your new predictive model map, you put it in here into MapCalc, and you just do a cutoff with an if statement. So you say if new predictive model is greater than or equal to 0.6, then 1. Otherwise, we're just going to actually turn it blank with a null value there. You could do 0 as well. And we'll be like, where to survey? You could hit run. And boom. So if I go back to our layers and I just sort of close out all the other maps and I put that guy here, what you can see is basically the parts of the landscape that have a reasonable chance of you finding some Neolithic sites. And if I zoom in on a part of this, you can see that it's the areas that are basically close to the watersheds, but that are also, of a certain slope and a certain aspect and a certain visibility as well. And so this can give you a little bit of an analytic to allocate where your survey efforts ought to go in a particular region. And of course, you'd want to be fine-tuning your predictive model much more so than I showed you in this sort of brief overview tutorial. The general procedures are the same, but you would want to spend a lot more time on determining your cutoffs, and you'd want to spend a lot more time on figuring out which inputs are actually important and which ones are not. Okay, so this tutorial, which I recognize is going on a little bit long now, is the last one up through Project 3. After this, we're going to get into imagery analysis, and then we're going to do some drone and LiDAR data analysis as well. So stay tuned for that, and I will see.